Right now, I'd say my career is focused less on specific research questions, hypothesis-driven questions, and more into clinical trials with devices. So we have one NIH grant that's looking specifically at the development of children who are hard of hearing, who are hearing aid recipients. Another project is a long-term project working with Dr. Naparko on how children develop with cochlear implants. This is a national study and a multi-center study, and we're now in our 11th or 12th year. But our most recent project, and the one we're very enthusiastic about, is about pediatric auditory brainstem implants in children. Now, this is not a new project by any means. Doctors William House and Doctors William Hitzelberger from the House, at that time was called the House Ear Institute, actually probably the Ear Research Institute, came up with this concept for their patients who had neurofibromatosis 2 or NF2. These are patients that have a terrible neurological disease where they have tumors growing on their nervous system, and usually both auditory nerves or vestibular nerves, and end up, just for life-saving reasons, having to have the tumors removed, and it renders them deaf. And so the two doctors, William House and Hitzelberger, came up with this implant that bypasses the cochlea, rests on the auditory brainstem or the cochlear nucleus. So that developed into a project. One of the implant companies started manufacturing, building the device and manufacturing it, went through FDA clinical trials, and now it's standard clinical procedure in the United States. But it's only approved for individuals 12 years and older who have this NF2. So, over 10 years ago, a doctor in Italy named Dr. Coletti, Vittorio Coletti, started conducting surgery using this electrode, this device, in patients who are non-NF2 for other reasons that caused their deafness, and they were not recipients of a cochlear implant, such as a temporal bone fracture where the nerve was severed, or meningitis where the cochlea was completely filled with bone, and started having quite improved results with this device than what you typically saw with individuals with NF2 who were recipients of the device. He then went to children who were not considered cochlear implant candidates and started showing some nice success with a segment of that population, not all of his children. So about 7-8 years ago, our team worked with the manufacturer that produces the device that's used in this country for this application about going to FDA to try this procedure in children or to start a clinical trial. They were not receptive. We sort of gave it up, and then families from the United States started traveling to Verona, Italy at great personal expense to have the surgery done there. And then these families came back and started looking for centers that could clinically manage their child. We became that center. So we've been following, I don't know, maybe 5, 6, almost 7 children who've had surgery in Italy. So based on this, we decided about 2 years ago to again approach the FDA, and this time they were receptive to the idea. And it's been a long, long, long journey, but a little over a year ago, we did receive FDA approval. And then we went and applied for a clinical trials grant with the National Institutes of Health, and have recently received that grant. So we're set to go, and we are having families contact us, audiologists contact us, neuro-otologists contact us saying, I have a patient, they're not candidates for an implant, their anatomy, you know, the anatomy doesn't support an implant. And so we are just about set to go. It's a 5-year, it's called a phase 1 safety feasibility study. And we've asked for support from the NIH for 5 years. And the FDA would not approve any more than 10 surgeries as a first look as a safety trial. We will enroll the first 5, conduct surgery, and follow these children for 1 year to look at medical, surgical safety, and programming safety. By that I mean electrical stimulation, programming the device, activation of the device. So after 1 year, essentially the safety component is over, and then we will continue to follow these children for efficacy for another 2 more years. That's the clinical trial. The first 5 children, we have to send all data to FDA. FDA will review it and tell us whether or not we can continue with the next 5 subjects. Our trial is a little different than some other trials going on in the United States in that we require, in most cases, the children to have a cochlear implant first. Some parents don't want to have their child go through that surgery. We'll either go straight to Italy or find one of the 2 or 3 other centers in the U.S. that don't have NIH funding for the project. The National Institutes of Health essentially insisted that be a condition of the trial, and so the children we're seeing have so far have all had cochlear implants and have not progressed in their auditory skill development. But I'd say the families are really on top of things. They have every service set up. They're very knowledgeable. They read the literature. And in a sense, these families are going to be part of our team and be our teachers as well. This will be the first time that we actually conduct the surgery. Dr. Coletti will fly in from Italy for our first 2 surgeries. Our surgeons have been to Italy a number of times to observe surgery. But I think our first programming of these children will be a new experience for us, and we're excited about it. I think before we started seeing the data come out of Europe, and the data from Europe, it involves children from a number of different countries that had surgery from Dr. Coletti, and they don't do a very formal follow-up. So it wasn't clear how well these children were performing with the device. I would say we had very low expectations based on what we knew from adults with NF2 that maybe they would get probably closed set word identification. In other words, they'd pick a word from a choice of words, but a not very good chance of understanding speech in an open set or through, telephone communication. The children that we started working with that came back from Europe, who were implanted very young, typically developing very strong parent. Very strong family commitment, and then all the habilitative programs in place. Some of these children started progressing very rapidly and starting to show similar development to, I would say, average performance or a little below average performance to children with a cochlear implant. And I think that really surprised me and really, it was pretty amazing, actually, to see these children developing spoken language. Now, these children are a little different than children with implants. One, they are still heavily reliant on lip reading, even if they do have some open set word recognition. They also have all come to us with sign language as their mode of communication. And we think that's very important for all of these children to have a language foundation. We don't know or can't predict what the ABI or auditory brainstem implant will provide them. So, but these top performers, actually, we're watching them dropping signs and starting to communicate with spoken language. Can't say their speech isn't as intelligible as children with cochlear implants, and this is something we hope to study as well. It's really a very small population of patients that are eligible for this procedure. Most children with severe to profound hearing loss easily fall into the cochlear implant category. That's now standard clinical procedure. But there's this small subset of children that, one, have not succeeded with the cochlear implant. We're also investigating this project. Why are there some children with implants that fail to progress in auditory skill development? One reason is their anatomy just doesn't support a cochlear implant. So for this small group of children and adults, as a matter of fact, this is one thing that can help them. And it's probably the last group that this now makes essentially all children eligible for some sort of sensory device technology. There's going to be some reasons some children won't succeed with this device, as with the cochlear implant. Additional disabilities, cognitive delays, other factors. But at least now this small subset of children now have an opportunity to hear if they're implanted young enough, they have some possibility of developing spoken language skills. Not all children will, but they certainly will have contact with an auditory environment.